You had said, I wasn't expecting to see you.
Caregiver Nakia Gaither helps her mother, Dorothy Gaither, age 72, get ready for exercise at the YMCA downriver in Southgate.
I thought I'd be physically fit till I was 90. I didn't think, you know, I'd have to have a caregiver. Well, I didn't until I caught COVID.
Dorothy, retired nurse, Detroit Medical Center.
I get up Monday through Friday between 4 and 4:30.
The regimen, trips to doctors, dialysis, physical therapy, the housework, and the fight to get healthy again.
When I got COVID, I got sick. I ended up on dialysis. That almost died on COVID. I was in a coma and everything, stuff I don't remember.
The thing is, before COVID, my job was, I was just her helper. Like, I would clean the house, you know, before she got really sick. She was independent.
Nakia, age 48, life interrupted, leaving a career as a performer and personal trainer traveling the world. Now, with Dorothy at her senior fitness class, Nakia leads a spin class down the hall.
Not over yet.
A respite from caregiving.
The role of a caregiver can be very small to massive.
Dana Lazenby is with the Oakland Community Health Network, connecting caregivers to resources.
Other family members may be on the peripheral, but that one care member that's a family member that's there 24/7 is critical to the health and safety of that individual they're helping to support in their home or spending the night with so that they can work and be a caregiver.
What does the typical caregiver look like?
We know that family caregivers are typically caring for a family member, a neighbor, a friend.
Rita Chula is with the AARP Public Policy Institute.
We know that 60% of family caregivers work at the same time that they're really doing a part-time job in providing care for someone else.
Does it taste good?
And many of these family caregivers are sandwiched, meaning that they're taking care of young children while they're taking care of older adults as well.
In Canton Township, 58-year-old Doria Rainey looks after her daughter's twin boys. That's just one day a week. She and her husband work at home. Their company manages websites.
Yeah, we're a team. Yeah, we are a team. So I'm thankful that my daughter is here, because if she wasn't, you know, it would be kind of hard.
The big lift, it's her mom with the recent onset of dementia.
I basically have three lives going on. For me, taking care of myself, my mom, and then the business. Caregivers know what caregivers go through, and the other people, they, you know, they'll hear it. Oh, you care for your mom, bless you, or something like that, but you don't know the struggles, the heartache, the pain.
So you can eat your lunch.
Doria's mom, age 78, not a talker. At least with Doria.
Everybody wants to be appreciated when they do something for you. Even if it's just, you know, thank you, or, you know, a big smile. A big smile will help a lot. She won't even do that for the most part. But it's been a struggle.
You're about to eat lunch, okay?
A Detroit News survey found African Americans make up the largest racial ethnic group of caregivers in Wayne County, 45%. And women make up more than 65%.
I'm the youngest. I'm number 6.
68-year-old retired teacher Rosa Hunter in Harper Woods with her mother, also named Rosa Hunter.
She's 94 and a half. She'll be 95 in July. Well, my mom was born in Birmingham, Alabama, and so she moved to Detroit and got married when she was 18. She used to be a dental assistant. She also was a counselor, as well as a pastor.
Younger Rosa's making a healthy lunch for mom.
Sea moss has 96 minerals and vitamins in it that our body needs. So I keep track of my mom's sleeping. Last night she went to bed at 8:30 and she woke up at 6 o'clock in the morning. So she slept 9.5 hours of sleep, which is so great.
Restless nights until Rosa started massaging her mom's legs at bedtime. It's vigilant in-home caregiving, keeping active, avoiding a nursing home.
She stayed by herself until she was 90 years old, but she got diagnosed with having dementia in her late 70s. But we didn't notice a lot at that time, and she was still able to be independent, take care of herself, cook for herself. the brain cells die, they shut down, they can't do anything. And I said, oh, I really don't want that to happen to her. So I'm gonna figure out a way and see if I can slow down the progression of dementia just by giving her healthy things, walking with her, talking with her, taking her places, listening to music, you know, just tapping into everything that I could about her body.
And many people don't understand mental health until it impacts them or somebody they love. And although we see it more now, which is probably the one good thing that came out of the whole pandemic, is that people are now talking about how critical it is for us to care for our mental health. But in our situation, we're talking about people who are living with a serious disorder and it's chronic.
Why do you think, given that everyone's going to be a caregiver or receive care at some point, just statistically speaking, it will happen to almost everyone, why do you think we don't study it more? Why don't we talk about it more?
Wow, first thing came to my mind is stigma. You know, people don't want to talk about people in their families who need certain levels of care. And hopefully, I think, I absolutely believe it's getting better. The other thing is, I think we don't see ourselves in that space.
I don't have a whole life. I have like a little bit of a life now, but I'm adjusting to figuring it out. You know, you would think, well, she wasn't real close to me. She wasn't, you know, didn't bond with me as a child. And but now I'm caring for her. I'm doing all these things for her. So I did have an issue at first, just mentally just taking care of her. So that was hard. For the most part, it's a lot, you know, physically dressing a whole person that's not helping. You know, she doesn't help at all. She can walk, but she keeps her legs like this. When the physical therapist came out, this one was like at a 45 degree angle. And then this one was 15, so we have to kind of exercise them. So it makes it hard to pull up pants and do everything, because she's not cooperating. Are you? You cooperating? You gonna say hi? You gonna talk? You know, I have to learn little techniques and strategies. So I look at YouTube videos. It's a young lady at my church. She took CNA classes, so I called her over and asked her to show me how to turn my mom in bed and, you know, just show me little things so I can be more efficient.
He'll be back in. There you go, there you go. He's doing the zoomies now. Out.
Back in their Gross Eels senior apartment, it's Nakia and Dorothy Gaylor's after lunch routine.
I don't sit down. It's nonstop until I go to bed, isn't it, Mom?
This outfit helps with blood circulation.
You feel it now? Everywhere?
A Detroit News survey found 52% of Metro Detroit caregivers have to pay out of pocket for caregiving materials. It can be hard to get insurance to cover outside help, just so primary caregivers can take a break.
They always look at the income, and so her income was, you know, higher than what was expected, so I couldn't really get help there. But I thank God that my sister comes every Tuesday to get her and take her out to eat. And my brother, even though he has Parkinson's, he can still be here present with her. And so he comes on Saturday so I can run my errands and do what I need to do personally.
As the survey found, no surprise, women more so carrying the load. Doria Rainey has two brothers.
So I was like, okay, guys, you know, I send them a text. Okay, guys, I need a break. Who can come and get mom? Or who can take her to their house or whatever? And I don't know how to care for her. I don't know who's gonna help me and things like that. But for me, it's like they just think that because I'm a female that I can do it, which I can, but they could hire somebody.
Nakia Gaither does see some compensation. It's through Medicare, where she clocks in as a caregiver.
My hours are 29 hours a week. That's what they have me on the clock. But as you see, this is more than 29 hours a week. She is under the Medicare Waiver Choice Program under Senior Alliance. They pay so much for a caregiver. So I get $329 a week, but that's her supplement income, not mine. So for the supplement income, that's for groceries. I have to put gas in the car to get her to the store. So it goes for me, but it's really for her.
Along with the spin classes, Gaither fits in some online food delivery work, a few hours a week if she's lucky.
We know that more than a quarter of caregivers are working 21 hours plus a week, which is a full-time job in addition to whatever other jobs they have. We know that around a quarter of them are doing it by themselves. They don't have other support. How do we make those kinds of things better for people when they're alone, they're doing their best, and they're working a lot while they're doing this, though?
I think natural supports have to be sometimes reimbursed. So you talk about natural supports in terms of, oh, well, you're a mom, you're supposed to do that, or you're the daughter, you're the closest family member to that person, you should do that, you have to do that. But we forget about all the other responsibilities a caregiver could have, and how do we find ways to help that person so they don't have to work 3, 4, or 5 jobs to take care of that individual when they need the help that they need.
Finding solutions as a family caregiver is the big question. Unfortunately, healthcare professionals and others make this mistake of thinking and taking for granted the role that family caregivers play and think it caring for someone just comes naturally. Mm-hmm. Well, you can care for someone and still need supports.
AARP helped make a scorecard ranking states by caregiving standards. Michigan, number 30. At the top, Minnesota and Washington.
Because we've really had an intentional focus on caregivers since 1989, and we've just been growing and evolving our program over that time.
Bea Rectors with Washington State's Aging and Long-Term Support Administration.
What do you think Washington is doing well in meeting caregivers where they are?
Well, I think we're doing well in a couple of areas, like Paid Family Medical Leave Act that was enacted and begun in 2020 that protects workers who need to take time off due to family caregiving to be able to do that up to 12 weeks and creates kind of a partial salary replacement for them to be able to do that so they're financially secure while they're caregiving. We also have the WA Cares Act.
WA Cares Fund is a benefit you earn, like Social Security,
which is a new long-term services and support insurance for working Washingtonians that will go into effect in July of 2026.
It can help pay for services you may need, such as in-home care or home-delivered meals.
And that will provide paid family caregiver supports to individuals who are eligible for those services. We also have a very supportive legislature because we've been able to talk about the value of caregiving, but also the value to the state budget in investing in family caregiver supports.
In Washington State, caseworkers assess caregivers' needs, help solve their problems while running a campaign promoting caregiving as the work it really is.
And basically it says, you know, you call it going grocery shopping for mom, we call it caregiving. You call it helping dad with medications, we call it caregiving. Please call, it's okay to ask for help.
For the caregivers here we talk to, they're making their way through so far.
I think she's still living a good life. She's not in any pain. She's not in and off the hospital. So you know, I thank God for that, you know, her quality of life, even though she's not really doing anything, she is still a good quality.
I mean, she's still here today and she's still asking questions and she can feed herself and she's not in a diaper at 94 and people are surprised, even the doctors are. It's just so many things she can do.
Rosa Hunter's success with her mom, maybe it'll rub off on some other East Side seniors. Rosa finds time to lead some exercise classes in Grosse Pointe Farms.
And I do cardio, but I also include foreign language, sign language, and sing-along songs at the end. Things that are good for your mental health as well as your physical health.
I'm 72. Mm-hmm. And I thank God for it. If I didn't have this walker, right now I would volunteer at least 2 days a week. Because I love caregiving.
She is able to walk everything.
I'm waiting on her legs.
Okay. You know, I have to help her get in and out of the tub, and sometimes I have to help her get up out of bed, but she's not bedridden. Excuse me, 1 second, let me check on her machine.
In Washington State and in Minnesota, they have a whole program dedicated to just like having a social worker or a caseworker check in with the caregiver and say, how are you doing? How can we connect you with resources?
Mm-hmm. I love that.
It's just truly like empathetic policymaking.
I love it.
Do you think we have that space here too?
I would love to explore that more because I absolutely think that does make a difference when you care about the direct care worker and how do we put them first and make them know how critical they are. I think they know, but money talks.
You can find more at onedetroitpbs.org or subscribe to our social media channels and sign up for our One Detroit newsletter.